story. I'm not going to stand on the stage because then you won't be able to see the slides. But so I'm going to start. I've got a question for you to ponder today. And that's that, what do these two people have in common? Like, at first glance, it seems like almost nothing. One's a young woman in a Japanese city. Another is an elderly man in an Indian village. Now, the worlds they live in are so different. Navigating a busy Japanese city is completely different than navigating an Indian village. But Google Maps has the word for both of these people. And the things that a young woman and an elderly man want to share are completely different too. But Facebook has the word for both of these people as well. Now, when I look back at the time we spent trying to solve these problems at Google and at Facebook, the thing that stands out to me is actually that these two different problems had a very, very similar solution. So first, I'm going to rewind back to 2005, when Google Maps first launched. You might notice a couple of countries missing here, but fast forward to today, and we've come a long way. You can now get directions in nearly every single country in the world. But with every single new country that we launched in, things got more complicated. I remember the first time going to India, and the thing that really stood out to me was everyone was saying, we're not like the rest of the world, we're different here. And you know what, they had a point. This is an example of some of the unusual traffic jams you can get into in India. This is actually a pedestrian footbridge, and we've got cows and motorcycles and all kinds of things. But the maps were different too. So if you look closely at this map, you might notice that something is missing here. There's no street names. There's no street names, and even less common in India, there's no numbers. So it turns out that a lot of the streets in India are actually not labeled, and it's even less common to have an address with a specific number. Now, there's lots of different reasons for this. The rate of change in India happens so fast that many of the streets genuinely don't have names, and even the ones that do, a lot of the time you can't see it because the street name could be obscured by some vegetation, it could be in the wrong language, because there's lots of different languages there, or it could even be that there's a high degree of literacy there. So all of this means that actually, back in the day when you used to get direction in India, they went something like this.
Continue on unnamed road. Turn left on unnamed road. Your destination is at unnamed road.
You can see why people were saying that India was different, right? But it actually wasn't just India. In Japan, it's completely the opposite. We have some of the most precise data anywhere in the world. But again, when I went to Japan, the thing that stood out to me was everyone was saying, hey, we're not like the rest of the world here. We're different. And I had a point in Japan, too. I remember the first time going there and being blown away by how many people there are absolutely everywhere. This is a photo just outside Shibuya Station. But yet, everything works so smoothly. And you can see that the maps in Japan are different, too. Now, there's all kinds of things on this map, but the one thing they don't have is street names. But here it's for a different reason. In Japan, addresses aren't described by the streets. They're actually described by the blocks, the space in between the streets. And this means that an address actually ends up looking a bit like a phone number. Something like District 1, Block 23, Building 5, Apartment 228. And so this means that although the data in Japan is incredibly precise, you end up getting directions something like this.
Continue on unnamed road. Turn left on unnamed road. Your destination is at 1, 2, 3, 5, 2, 2, 8.
So you can see why people were saying that Japan was different. But it wasn't just India and Japan, actually. In every single new country we went to, people were saying, hey, we're not like the rest of the world. We're different here. It turned out that every single country was different, and every single country had unique needs. How can you possibly build directions that work just as well for a Japanese city as they do for an Indian village? That was the problem that the Google Maps team were facing. Now, the Facebook sharing team had a problem too. This is how Facebook looked when it launched in 2004, back when it was the Facebook, still, for anyone who's watched the movie. And Facebook's come a long way since then as well. Facebook now serves over a quarter of the world's population. But the interesting thing here is that the things that all these people want to share are so different to each other. In fact, there's an almost infinite number of different things that people want to share. So how can you possibly build tools to support all of these different types of things? So maybe, this is a really difficult problem actually, so maybe we can do this by maybe like dividing people to try and figure out some of the traits they have. So you can start looking at things like, where are they in the world? What country are they in? Are they in a rural or an urban area? Maybe you can separate people by age, whether young or old. You can look at gender, like male or female, where actually there's a ton of other official genders that you can recognize. You can look at their education level. You can look at, are they on mobile or desktop? Maybe you're going to look at, are they really infrequent users, or are they incredibly frequent users that share the entire time? Or maybe you want to look at the different types of things that people want to share. Are they sharing text? Are they sharing photos? Are they sharing videos? This list is actually never ending. And the more things you add, the more complicated it gets. So how can we possibly build sharing tools that support the things that young women and an elderly man want to share? And that was the problem that the Facebook sharing team were facing. Now you start looking at these two different problems, and you realize that these problems have got so big that it's actually unfeasible to solve them. The breakthrough came when we stopped looking at all the ways in which people were different and started paying attention to the ways in which people were all the same. So if you go to India today and you ask for directions, people aren't going to give you this in terms of street names and numbers. They're going to say something like, go past the temple, it's across the street from the school, just opposite the lake. They use landmarks to help to describe how to get around. And if you look at the map, you can see that while there aren't any street names on the map is full of landmarks that the local people used to get around. It turns out that Japan has got a very similar situation. Because of that really complex address system that nobody actually knows or uses on the ground, people use landmarks to describe how to get around. And again, you can see no street names, loads of landmarks all over the map that people use to get around. Now it turns out that it doesn't matter where you go in the world, from Tokyo to Bangalore to London, people use landmarks to get around. And when you look at this is just overhead of where we are today, suddenly you realize everything here is a landmark. The crypt on the green, obviously, is a landmark. The St. James's Church, John, just outside, that's a landmark. Farrington Tube Station, that's a landmark. Clerkenwell Road, that's a landmark too. It turns out that the street names are just another type of landmark. The Google Maps teams have been using landmarks all along. They've just only been using one specific type. So with that insight, we went back and we upgraded the directions to use street names when we had them, and then roll back and use other types of landmarks when that was available. And that upgraded the directions. So now in India, when you ask for directions, you get something a bit more like this.
Continue past KMK complex. Turn left at Goda Temple. Your destination is on the left opposite the big banyan tree.
Awesome landmark, right? So much better. So it turns out that the people in Japan and the people in India were actually really similar. By focusing on the commonalities instead of the differences, the Google Maps is able to help people get around no matter where they are in the world. But what about this Facebook sharing problem? Like, how are we possibly going to solve for all of these different things that people want to share all around the world? Now, one question you might ask is, like, why are you trying to get people to share more things? Like, I'm sure that you've got a few friends, I know I have, that have no problem sharing stuff on Facebook and do it all the time. But also, we've all got quite a few friends that don't really share anything. And it's a shame, because sometimes you need to know about the meaningful things that are happening in people's lives. And these are the people that we really want to try and encourage to be able to share more things. Now, it turns out that the breakthrough here came when we stopped thinking about what the things were that people wanted to share, and we started asking ourselves, why aren't they sharing it already? And it turns out that the things that are stopping people from sharing are not mechanical things like usability on your mobile phone or like I'm next to my desktop or something like that. They're psychological barriers. And it turns out then that instead of looking at the specific types of things that people wanted to share, and by focusing on the universal barriers that are psychological that stop people from sharing, that was going to be the solution. So this is a photo that I took of my son back when we were in Glasgow a few months ago. You can see that he's looking like pretty happy here. Little does he know that he was about to try haggis for the first time a bit later. Now I always think that he looks adorable, but to be honest, this is not the best photo I've ever taken of him. It's like slightly blurry, the lighting's not great, composition is not amazing. This is not a good enough photo, frankly, that I would share it on Facebook. And this is a shame because I know that his grandparents would love to see photos of him. So I've done a pretty technical diagram here, so follow along. This is the range of quality that everything can be, from either bad to good enough to awesome. And right here in the middle, we have a bar, and this is the quality bar. This is how good something needs to be before I'm ready to post it on Facebook. And you can see here, this photo of my son, clearly not passing that psychological barrier. It's not passing the quality bar, so I'm not going to share it. So what can we do? What can we do to make this good enough that I feel encouraged to share it? Well, one approach we could do is we could actually raise the quality of this photo, this post that I'm going to do, and that would get over the bar. Another approach is we could actually lower that psychological quality bar for me. That would make it easier for me to feel to share this without changing the quality. Now, if you're clever, you'll probably do both. And that's what the Facebook sharing team did. So you can see this theme quite clearly in some of the more recent launches that they've done. So if you look at the Facebook camera, they've now introduced like a ton of really new cool features. They've got masks, so I can turn my son into a cute little raccoon. That's a really fun thing to do. Or maybe I want to go a bit more classy, and I'll add a nice filter so I can make it look like a kind of classy pencil sketch here. And this kind of filter will raise the quality of my content and give me something that I feel more proud to share and overcome that barrier. But on the flip side, the Facebook Live camera, that lowers that psychological quality barrier by enabling people to broadcast live video straight from their phone. Now, I was actually thinking about broadcasting my son's reaction to trying haggis for the first time, but I actually thought that was too cruel. But the cool thing about live video is that it's candid and it's raw, and you can't edit it, you can't perfect it, so everyone actually expects it to be a bit more low quality. Like, they expect that quality bar to be lower. And so that lowers that psychological quality bar. And so it turns out that the psychological barriers that are preventing the young woman and the elderly man from sharing are the same. So by focusing on the way that people are the same, the Facebook team allows people to connect and share with each other no matter where they are in the world or what they have to say. So now if we look back to the young woman in the Japanese city and the elderly man in the Indian village, we realize that they have a lot more in common than we first thought. It's really, really easy to focus on the differences between people. But if we want to build great products that make life better for people all around the world, we really need to start focusing on how similar we all are as human beings. And it seems to me that there's never been a better time to start. That's it. Thank you.